Welcome back. In this lecture, we'll be talking about food as it relates to the topics of this course. So humans, as a species, are very good planners. And one of the main kinds of planning that we do is to allow for the production of more and more food. And one of the main ways we do this is through agriculture. Agriculture certainly allows for the production of a lot more food than, for example, we had when we were hunter-gatherers as a species. It's also been proposed that one of the reasons why we may have begun agriculture is to produce grain in order to make alcohol, that the idea of having enough grain to ferment into beer as a surplus was very desirable to humans. I'm not sure that we have a good, if the jury's determined whether or not that's exactly why it evolved, but it's been proposed by researchers. There are a lot of IT techniques that are brought to bear in terms of modern agriculture. So measuring the impacts of different agricultural systems, allowing for more precise control over the inputs and outputs, enabling supply chain management, how food, once it's been grown, moves through the industrial infrastructure, allowing for more informed eating, knowing about the caloric count and the nutrition, and also allowing potentially for social networks to manage and distribute local food supplies that are produced as well, things like community-supported agriculture. And in this course, if sustainability is a focus, you might think, what's the information that we currently have when we look at a piece of food that allows us to know about what the sustainability implications of that food is? We have a lot of nutrition information on the back of each package, but not that much sustainability information. What kinds of information should be on that food packaging? Should there be a carbon footprint? Should there be a water footprint? That's an interesting topic, I think, what information we would want if instead of a nutrition facts, we had a sustainability facts. Also, what thought should be put into packaging itself? What materials should be used and how should it be shipped that allow for there to be less packaging per unit of food produced? An interesting photo essay that was done on modern food that shed some light on modern food is called 37 Ingredients in a Twinkie. Apparently there are 37 ingredients in a Twinkie, and at a site linked into the Canvas class website, you can see pictures of the 37 different ingredients. And while there are some things you'd recognize, like wheat flour and water, and three or four different things that are basically sugar. So sugar, corn syrup, high fructose corn syrup, I think there's fructose and maybe one other one, glucose, I think. There are dozens of other ingredients that are that would fit more in a chemistry textbook than on a farm. And so I encourage you to go take a look at that and see what the ingredients are in Twinkie and what they look like. The ingredients in a Twinkie are very different from the kinds of foodstuffs we had on the evolutionary landscape. When humans were evolving, we ate very different things than what we find in a Twinkie. Modern agriculture is very different from what we evolved to, the kinds of food gathering that we evolved to be good at. And agriculture also has a lot of other environmental implications. So agriculture is heavily intertwined with water. There's an article from a few years ago in Science magazine called, "Is Agriculture Sucking Fresh Water Dry?" In this article, it talks about a variety of different aspects of water consumption around the world. It points out that the U.S. leads the world in per capita water consumption, more than twice the global average. Various of the statistics in this article are striking, similar to the idea that we have more than twice the global average of water. But there is also, it points to some of the complexity that there is in calculating the water. Should you count the water used to produce food? They certainly do, and they in fact suggest that 92% of all of the water consumed is used to support modern agriculture. They suggest that it takes 5,300 liters of water to grow and process a dollar's worth of grain. That's a pretty dramatic figure, considering that, you know, a box of cornflakes is only a couple of dollars. It represents a huge amount of water that went into all of the processes. The article also uses a saying that I really kind of liked, which is grain is the currency by which we trade water. What this is suggesting is that in international commerce, it would be very hard to move water around, but water is ultimately very valuable. But since grain is a representation of how much water was put into that grain, it allows us to do exchanges without having to ship all the water around. It allows us to ship the grain around instead. It also talks about virtual water, which it says is 1/5 of all water use. It defines this as the water needed to produce a commodity, such as meat or electronics, if the ultimate consumers were to make it themselves rather than to outsource its growth or manufacture. And this points to another piece of this complexity, the fact that when you have a product, there is a lot of embodied water. Just as there's embodied energy, there's a lot of water that was used to make that thing. And that needs to be taken into account at some point in the way we understand the global flows of water. Here we see a map that shows some of these global flows. It shows which countries are importing and exporting to which other countries. And it's interesting to see some of the ways in which the US factors into these imports and exports. The article also says to reduce water use, it encouraged people to eat less meat or to switch from grain-fed beef, which, as you mentioned before, requires 5,300 liters of water for each pound of each dollar's worth of grain fed to a cow, to grass-fed beef, which typically requires only the water, the rainwater falling on a pasture. Here in California, we face some major water issues. Some of these tied up in the idea of meat, because if you've ever driven up the 5 freeway, you can see that there are a lot of cows there. Water in Southern California is typically piped in from lots of other parts of the state, as well as from other states. And there are lots of different ways to reduce water usage. So for example, reducing lawn watering, since the water used to water lawns is not reclaimed, unlike the water used for sewage. Back on the topic of eating habits, thinking about the calories of fossil fuels that are used for each calorie of protein. With beef, it's a 35-to-1 ratio, that the amount of energy that you need to produce one calorie of beef protein is 35 calories of fossil fuel. And for tofu, though, the ratio is only 2-to-1, that it only requires twice as much energy, which still seems like a reasonable amount, but not nearly as much as with beef. And so between these two, the idea that water is being used heavily for the production of meat, and also that there is energy being used abundantly for the production of meat, provides some suggestion that a vegan or a vegetarian diet might have some significant environmental benefits, as well as there being health and moral arguments for that as well. And in previous offerings of this class, a number of students have looked at the question of vegan and vegetarian diets for their final projects. I imagine some of you in this class are looking that direction as well. So this lecture has provided a basic introduction of some of the ideas around food as they relate to the topics of this class. Thanks very much.